Chapter 5. I needed to remain calm and collected. I took in a deep breath and blew it out. I repeated and repeated until I felt like I could breathe and wipe my face without needing to do so again. I had not cried in years, and this incident felt like tossing a handwritten novel into the fire. Slowly, I lifted my head and unclasped my right arm from my legs and took my left hand off my head and placed both my hands flat to the ground by my sides. I pulled my legs underneath me, pressed my hands to the ground, and acquainted my feet with my weight. My legs vacillated and I limped before relearning to walk. I reached the corner of the room where stood a small water cooler with a metal cup on the floor. At least they trusted me with water. As I got some of it and gulped it down, I felt the tides take over everything, utterly silencing the chaos, before ensuing into the quiet rustle of waves as they lightly splashed against one another. I felt like I had stopped a hurricane from obliterating the bit of hope left in me. I looked up at the wall in front of me and started to inspect every inch of it to keep me calm for a little while longer. Then I inspected the other, then the third, and then the last, as if looking for a crack that would turn into a door and get me out of here. I dared not to touch it, as if it was laced with a poison slower and more torturous than this. The dirty white paint peeled off from multiple places, tempting me to reach out and push it back so it would crack and fall as soon as I would pull my hand away. The gray bricks of the wall to the bathroom had successfully broken free from concealment and were ready to share their lonely stories. The stories of those they were made to watch and then mine to the ones who will come after me. They were to thank the pipes that slid along their bodies and let water tear the veil they hid behind. The snakes were almost black, but the rust tried its best to add some color. The repulsing odor filled the room and tried its best to form a layer of itself in my throat. The dampness of the room made it harder to breathe, and I had not realized I was silently gasping for uncontaminated air in the toxicity I was surrounded by. Like gunshots was the rhythm of my heart that amplified the thudding from above. I shuddered at the sound of the feet of the lunatic upstairs entering my room from the top left, the middle, and the top right. It was my first month here and I was already sick. It was not the isolation that was bothering me, it was the thought of what I was to face when human interaction could be avoided no further. Now that I could hear the woman above no longer, I believed it was night time, for the inhumane voices had turned into silence. But when I listened hard enough, there were some quiet snores. I heard that I was one of the most dangerous patients. I was surrounded by women who did not know what they were doing. I was kept with the most impotent of women who had no reason to exist any longer as everyone waited for them to drop dead. Feeling a blob at the back of my nose from all the crying, I went to the bathroom, blew my nose, and began coughing. I winced as I felt my throat peel before I sighed and splashed my face with the water and confronted the very thing I was eluding all these days. Staring at me was a young girl who looked like she had witnessed her entire world crumble before her red eyes. Water droplets rolled down her face to her chin, where they accumulated into a drop and waited for an acquaintance to reach and substitute its position while it jumped to its depth, where it would splatter and show no traces of who it was. The skin around her eyes had started to swell with a pinkish hue. The emaciated lips that had been colorless throughout these years and completely white for these past few days were now betraying their true shade. The shadows her hollow eyes casted were emphasized by the colorless face. This ugly painting was framed with black coal, ready to be burnt red to make the picture it bore to die with it. I could see them pushing me down and hollering at me and criticizing me, and an uncouth side of myself thrashing around as those five women pinned me down to get the task done. The first session for the electric shock treatment was to begin tomorrow, and I felt weary and tired of it already. Tearing my eyes from her, I walked to the bed and lay down before pulling my legs to my chest. Sighing, I extended one of my legs until its toe touched the folded sheet at the foot of the bed. I curled my toes around a fraction of the fabric and pulled it up where my hands would reach it. Grabbing it, I spread it upon myself. I lay on my left with my arms in front of my face as if my wrists were handcuffed. I could not stop thinking about it. I thought and thought and thought how I should not think about it and thought once more. I was killing myself by doing this and I knew it. I wanted to die already before it started. I could not handle it. I just wanted to pull my hair out. My hands were shaking and I could do nothing to stop them. I could not stop watching myself lie in one of those beds and beg for them to stop while they just looked at me with dead eyes and smiled as if playing the role of Satan himself. I tossed and turned and imagined myself tied down and acted out how it was going to be. I brought my legs up and thrashed them to the bed, pulling my lower body up with the force and throwing it back. I did this over and over. Tomorrow this movement was just going to be one dimension of the many. I was going to shake and shake and shake until I died of shaking. Why was my mind not blank like it always was? Why was I suddenly bestowed with the gift of thought as if I had passed under the eyes of a philanthropist? Why were my imaginative skills working like they had never done before? Sweat washed over my body, but I still did not stop moving, nor did I stop thinking. This time I did not fall back down, but threw the tangled sheets to the side and leapt out of bed. I needed to escape tonight. But how was I to break this metal door to its hinges when all I had were thoughts piling upon themselves until I could no longer see the other side? I paced around the room, first back and forth, then in the square form the room was. I heard my legs scream in agony, but this was dictatorship, not democracy. I believed my head was about to burst before I collapsed to the floor and endeavored to compose myself. I stared up at the ceiling and breathed in and out, hoping for this episode to end, but it could not, and I already knew that. My body slightly jolted before going completely still when I heard someone speak. I had forgotten I was never alone. "No point of fretting about it. You deserve it after what you did," said her voice. She never spoke again that night, for she had enough followers to carry out the task. They spoke all at once, deafening me. I could only make out a few words. Useless, worthless, hopeless, lazy, ugly, traitor. But it was time I could no longer sort out the drops that built up the tsunami. There were too many of them. I endeavored shutting my eyes to block them out, but I did not stand a chance against all of them. Perhaps electroconvulsive therapy could help me strip myself off them. I could finally be the voice inside my head. Never. I screamed in the low voice I always did. I could no longer find quiet in all this silence. I hit my head in a futile effort to kill them, but they lived on and will continue doing so, as they would dance on my grave when the only ones to grace me with their company will be the hungry pests trying to stay alive. I needed to write to Timothy more than ever, but I had no paper nor pencil. I told myself to just imagine myself writing it down. I needed to string words into sentences, sentences into paragraphs, and paragraphs into a letter. I needed to put these thoughts in an envelope that will never exist. I forgot the English language and found myself tied up in the language of thought. I thought of Miss Charlotte. She would say something worthwhile and aid me in overcoming this aphasic barrier, but she was not here. No one was. I once more learned the art of turning abstraction to words that night. It helped me forget about the following day for a while, and I was grateful for it. After what felt like years of learning the English language and stopping myself at the door of thought, I returned to my room of education. I found the lost ability of piecing together the puzzle I was in need of designing. Timothy, I thought. Your promise seems to be drowning in an ocean, much to my misfortune. The pain is still there, worse than ever, and I am led to believe the only one to blame is me. All the times I told you there was something wrong with me are now flashing before my eyes, followed by your words. There's nothing wrong with you, my dear. I wish you would believe me. You never lied, so I cannot say that you were lying when you said those words. You just did not want to believe someone you knew could be in such a horrible place. Your compassionate words are all I need right now. Something inexplicably bad is going to happen, and I'm glad you'll never know about it. End of chapter 5.